So yeah, so welcome to this. I think this is our third Twitch live live stream session, talking about all things Torizon live coding. And we thought we'd try something a little different this time and get another voice in here. So I have asked Leonardo Veiga to join us to answer questions about Torizon. So Leo is our architect and product manager for the Torizon product, and he's here to answer questions. I did gather some questions ahead of time, but if there are people on the chat that do have questions, I've got the chat window open. Feel free to post your questions in the chat, and we will try to pass them on and get them answered. So, Leo, let's just start with a little bit, if you don't mind, just, you know, kind of share a little bit about yourself, you know what your role is at Toradex, and you know, how long you've been working with Torizon and that kind of thing.
Sure, Drew. And first of all, thanks so much for inviting me. I'm happy to be here today with you and everybody who's following up. Yeah, my name is Leonardo, but for short, you can call me Leo. That's how people call me at Toradex, and you watching can also do the same. I've been in the company for about 6 years now. I started on January 2016 as an intern for Embedded Linux. And back then there was no Torizon yet. We only had a distribution based on Angstrom with an LXDE desktop environment and all. And that's when I learned a lot, because I was doing some support, so like an intern for the FAE team. And then I had to help customers solve a variety of different, you know, different technical challenges, and that that was when I learned it a lot. And I also started writing some articles that initially for the Brazilian market, and then translating them to English under the supervision of the people here back when I started. And that became something more regular, which led me to transitioning to the technical marketing team, which was actually didn't exist back then, but then it was created. And let's say 9 months ago or so, the opportunity came up, and there was an opening to become a TorizonCore product owner. Because we are a Scrum team, so there was this position open, and I think it was the perfect match from of everything I've learned before and the experiences I've had trying to bring Scrum to technical marketing. So here I am today, and I'm very happy to be part of the Horizon Core team.
Yeah, and I can say we're definitely happy to have you. It's been last couple months we've been working much more closely together, and that's been a very good thing. So I kind of want to start at the big picture level. So, you know, I have in the past couple sessions tried to describe Torizon and why you might want to use it, but, you know, I'd like to hear your thoughts on what is the point of Torizon? Why yet another Linux system? What's different about it from, you know, the Angstrom distribution or the standard BSP reference images, and why should customers consider investing time and effort into Torizon?
Yeah, that's a broad question, maybe a bit tough one, but I'll provide my point of view here. And to answer that, maybe I have to go back to the early days of Torizon and how did it come to life. And in a summary, I don't want to get boring here, but in a summary, it came as a very in-depth study which had many, let's say, many phases, and included customer interview rounds, in-depth customer interview rounds, evaluating many possibilities like Android, Yocto, Debian, Linux microplatforms, a lot of different possibilities. You know, it wasn't even constrained to Linux. And this study targeted at providing a migration path for our Windows CE customer base, because Windows CE is coming end of life, and easy to use, which addresses all our customer base, not only the Windows CE ones. Because we also see a trend for people that usually they come from desktop or, you know, from Windows, and they start doing embedded development, embedded Linux development, and that can be quite complex depending on what you're going to do and the size of your team.
Sure, sure.
And Torizon aims to address all these needs. So it's an easy to use, ready to use, production quality embedded Linux distribution. So why should I use it instead of Yocto or something else? Because it's easy, it's well maintained, you can update it across its the entire life cycle of your product without paying in a very easy way. So yeah, that's a summary of how I see it.
And did you see sorry about my dog. That just proves we're actually live. You don't get that in pre-recorded stuff. So he's a little 12-pound guy who thinks he's a 60. So he may decide to chime in here, especially if we start talking BeagleBone. That gets him going. sorry, bad yeah. jokes. No, but do you see? And I've never worked with Windows CE. I came into the company directly working on Torizon. So do you see a lot of difference in the pain points that WinCE customers have versus those that are coming from, say, a Yocto or just a desktop slash server style Linux background? Because I'm just not familiar with Windows CE at all.
Yeah, ever since I joined it, I maybe booted Windows CE once or twice.
Okay.
Okay. I didn't do much. The person who conducted the study, they knew it quite well, and they, you know, in order to make the better decisions. But I think I'm not the best person to answer this question.
Yeah. Okay, so let's dig in a little bit then in some of the technologies that make up Torizon. So you know, I guess the probably the most visible thing to end users is the container runtime. So why include a container runtime in embedded? Aren't embedded workloads typically limited functionality enough that container runtimes are you know, overhead that may or may not provide any value?
Yeah, that's a question that it's been raised in the past, especially when we were starting. There was some you know, people were questioning about it. And I think it comes from the fact that many see containers just like a lightweight virtual machine.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a misconception, because with containers, you just have, you know, let's say a sandboxed environment where your process cannot access the host, which would be, you know, the underlying operating system. But you, I will not say you don't have, but you have minimal CPU performance and RAM memory, let's say, penalties for using the containers. And because it ships an entire root file system, then you have, to some degree, a bigger footprint on the flash memory. Not necessarily about I/O operations, but the size of things that you must store there. And that's usually for our hardware, for our customers, for our scenario, that's hardly ever a problem, because all our boards supported by Torizon, they use eMMC as the flash memory, and the minimum is 4 gigabytes. So very rarely someone needs more than that, and if they need more than that, it's usually on a more powerful hardware, which anyway have, you know, 8 gigabytes, 16 gigabytes of eMMC.
Yeah, so I mean, compared to a, you know, traditional embedded, obviously, you know, embedded Linux, you know, you've got the very deeply embedded developers who are, you know, MCU developers doing bare metal control loops and things like that. They look at something like you know, our SOMs that are capable of running Linux, and you know, the spec differential between them is pretty stark. So I guess that's one of the things, you know, because a lot of people, when they come, they're thinking embedded, they're thinking, you know, small 16 32-bit micros with, you know, 64K rather than multiple megs or gigs of RAM and flash. So I guess that makes sense. So why Docker specifically? I mean, I know there's a lot of choices for container runtimes, and you know, I myself am familiar enough with Docker, but I'm just curious how much research was done on other container runtimes, and if there's any, you know, flexibility or consideration for potentially supporting other runtimes in the future.
Yeah, then maybe I start with why a container runtime, which I think is part of your last question, but I just remember right now. We wanted to give people a means to easily keep the base OS up to date without them needing to do it, and people can focus, our customers can focus on writing and work on their applications. And containers, they provide this environment very easily out of the box. And maybe we can go in detail later, but that's, you know, one big reason why containers. And then why Docker? Initially, in our studies, we started evaluating, for example, Balina, which they use Mobi under the hood, and we did some investigations in the past. We even have a Podman experimental build that we don't advertise too much because it's not maintained by ourselves, but we are keeping an eye. And the thing is, we'll use a container runtime that's reliable because we're talking about embedded, and as much as possible, that provides the lowest footprint possible because that's also good for embedded. So okay. This is the rationale. There is not much to look under the hood.
So okay, so going down a level from there, inside the containers, why did we choose Debian as the base for our reference containers?
Yeah, that's a good question. It also goes back to the early days of Torizon and to that study to which I referred previously. We've noticed that among the many possibilities that we could choose from, let's say open embedded with Pokey, open embedded with full-fledged distro, Android, and etc. Debian was something that our customers, they had an interest into. They wanted to have a similar customer experience that the one provided by Debian. Possibly because it has the apt package manager, it has the package feeds with a myriad of packages that most likely, you know, anything the customer needs or majority of that is provided already by the open source community in a Debian package. And of course, maybe because of Raspberry Pi, because they have Raspbian, which derived from Debian, had Raspbian, now the name changed, but anyway, derived from Debian. So also, you know, there may be some, let's say, some general interest there. And I think that's also good because Debian is known to be a very stable Linux distro, you know.
Sure.
Even though they don't have the packages updated to the bleeding edge all the time. And sometimes that can be, I don't know, if you're looking for a specific package, that then you may need to build it from source. But overall, it's a good trade-off because you have something that's stable.
Right, right. And then, of course, Debian already has pretty good support for ARM processors, so there's not a whole lot of recompiling or anything needed. Is that correct?
Yeah. most of the times, both for the 32-bit, the ARM HF, and for the 64-bit, the ARM 64, that's true. Sometimes, you know, maybe you don't have something for the 32-bit and you need to compile yourself, but I don't hear much in that direction.
Okay. So we got a question in the chat. Looks like it's Premi Appen, I think is the name. Sorry if I mispronounced that. But let's take another step back to kind of the higher level. What are the overall capabilities of Torizon considering OTA updates? And I guess I would add to that just in general the whole Torizon platform. We've been talking about the actual client OS, but what does Torizon provide as a full platform for users?
So about OTA updates.
Well, and other features that are provided by the platform services part of Torizon.
Okay, yeah. Let me see where to start. Well, let me start from the updates and then go to talking about other features. The update stack that we used, it contains two major pieces of software. They are called OS3, which is sometimes referred to as a Git-like library for file system versioning operations. And then on top of that, we have Actualizer, which is an OTA implementation of the Uptain standard, which is an OTA update standard that's widely used in the automotive industry. And Actualizer, it uses OS3, and it's the one that communicates with the server, that allows the metadata and data exchange to happen in a secure fashion. Probably I don't want to go much deeper on that point, because we have another person at Toradex who's a specialist on all of that security part. But if you want to learn more, look for OS3 and Actualizer. We have resources on our developer website, and they are open source projects, so you can actually, you know, even go down to source code if you want to.
Mm-hmm.
And they the OS3 runs on the board, and the Actualizer, it has a libactualizer, which is a client that runs on the board and communicates with a compatible server. So Toradex also provides app.torizon.io, which we sometimes refer to as the platform services, where you can manage your devices, your fleets of devices. You can push an OTA update to one board or to many boards, and you can, you know, create different fleets. For example, if you have two different products, in this platform, so now broadening a bit, we also provide at the moment device monitoring. And therefore you can send metrics to the server, and you can watch, for instance, you can watch the CPU load, CPU temperature, or disk consumption. But the nice thing about our implementation of the monitoring is that you can send any metrics you want. We have documentation on how you can do that, and that's the cool thing, because each customer has a different requirement. They need to monitor something different. So this is what we have today, and we listen to the customers, so we also of course have a roadmap to improve that. And what I can say, it's a really interesting thing that's coming up. And you may have even watched the webinar a couple of weeks ago, is the secure offline updates. Many customers, they can't have the device connected, but they must update the device nevertheless. even either the application or the OS, and they want to do it in a secure way. They don't want to update the wrong thing by mistake, because you know, it's very different when you have someone in the production line with two USB sticks and you know, maybe they make mistake. So we are implementing secure offline updates using the same software stack, using both OS3 and Actualizer, which is very nice because they are open source. They comply to the Optane standard, which is you know, a standard used by even by mostly by automotive industry, so must be very secure. And yeah, other things coming up, such as remote device access, it's coming up. We also, you know, have some let's say we have the monitoring and want to do some alarms, you know, if a parameter gets out of range and things like that. So the platform is pretty cool.
Yeah, and then there was another comment from Permiap, and there's a whole lot about OTA on the website. And yes, that's true. It's been a big marketing push for us, so you're going to see a lot about that. That's the first big feature that's part of the platform services. But you know, like Leo said, you know, we've got other things in there. We've got the device monitoring. We've got fleet monitoring. We will eventually have remote access and things to help troubleshooting and that kind of thing. So over time, those platform services will be built up, and you'll see additional details showing up on our website about those kind of things. So Leo, what about the how does Torizon help application developers? What features are part of Torizon that could be used to help develop an app? You know, if I'm getting ready to start, you know, I want to write an app in Python, or I want to integrate with you know, some specific service that's available as a Docker container. What's the best way to get started with that kind of thing?
There are many ways to get started, and let's say maybe my answer is a bit opinionated, but it's the one I truly believe delivers you the best value, in a sense that you can start faster, you can get your application running faster, and it makes it easier to maintain that over time. And we at Toradex, we have developed what we call IDE extensions. So they are, let's say, plugins or extensions for some IDEs that you can install them, and in a couple of minutes you have your application running on the target with the cross development toolchain all set. So you don't have to configure the SDK, you don't have to configure the debugger, you know, GDB, PDB, whatever. And usually something that would easily take a week or more if you want to do it, you know, following best practices and all. So we have those IDE extensions. For Visual Studio, we have Visual Studio 2019. We have the IDE extension that supports C and C++ development. And for Visual Studio Code, there are three major languages supported: the C and C++ as well, the Python, and .NET.
Okay.
So the nice thing is that along with this support, we also provide some templates for you to get started quickly. And with those templates, for example, if you want to develop a Python graphical application, we provide a Qt template, so you can use, you know, PySide, PyQt. For C++, we also provide Qt QML, Qt widgets template. And for .NET, we have recently bumped to stable the UNO platform, so .NET users now they have this in the stable support of the extension. And other frameworks for .NET could be used with some effort or some samples.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
But The extension makes it easy because you have all these, you know, these initial stuff that, you know, abstracted. So makes your life much easier in the beginning. And also, the IDE extension goes all the way to the integration with the platform. So you can even push, you know, you stop, you finish developing version 1.0 of your application, and from the IDE you can even push it to the platform, and then perform a remote update to your small fleet of devices, you know, that maybe you have on a wall in your office, and then you validate stuff. So yeah.
Okay. So then where does TorizonCore Builder fit in?
Okay, yeah. TorizonCore Builder, I don't consider it application development by itself. I think it's about OS customization. So let's say if you're a one-man team, you do everything. But if you have two developers there, maybe one of them is doing the application development and the other is doing the OS customization, because you just want to parallelize your work and, you know, be as efficient as possible. TorizonCore Builder is a tool that allows our customers to do OS customization in general, because, well, we want to provide TorizonCore as an easy to use platform. And we know that the Octo project is very powerful, is very nice, but it's hard to learn and hard to master. Therefore, we created TorizonCore Builder to provide a quicker, easier user experience there. And some examples of things that you could do with TorizonCore Builder: you could customize your splash screen. You could add containers to an image. So, you know, when you install it in factory, it already has your application there. You could support a custom carrier board. TorizonCore Builder has support for device tree and device tree overlays customization. You can add your custom kernel drivers and a lot of those things. Mm-hmm. That they will make the environment for you to build your application on top of that. And TorizonCore Builder, it was born as a command line tool, and it is a command line tool. And now, let's say 2 or 3 months ago, I'm not pretty sure, but it was recent, we integrated TorizonCore Builder into the Visual Studio Code extension. Therefore, the customers, they can have easy of use using this tool as well. Visual Studio Code has IntelliSense, so you can, you know, easily customize your OS editing a single YAML text file, and you already have commands and buttons to build your custom image, deploy it to a local device via SSH, or even push it to the platform in order to operate OS updates.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, interesting. Okay, so let's dig down a little bit. I got some solicited questions ahead of time. So there's a couple things here more about, you know, the nuts and bolts of how you do things. So a couple questions came in on, you know, how much do I need to know about Docker and, you know, the inner workings of it? You know, why is it so difficult to get access to a device? You know, I've seen a lot of different settings that that are used on the Torizon reference containers, what, you know, C group rules and things like that. That seems pretty complex. Why is all of that needed, and what does that provide to the end user?
Yeah, that's a good question. So, what do you need to learn about Docker? Initially, not much, and honestly, it's become popular because it's easy to use. But we can leverage many nice things that come with Docker on the security perspective. So in one of the first questions today, we discussed the fact that Docker, it's like a sandbox that allows your application to run isolated from the host OS. And if you think about that, it means that your application initially would not have access to the underlying hardware, because you know that's controlled by the host OS. And then you're talking about embedded systems and you want to do hardware access. So there are two ways to do it. There is the easy way, which you know you can run your container privileged and bind mount all the directories that you want, you know, bind mount slash you know the directories from the root that that allows device access, slash C's or slash dev, and then you're ready to go. But then you lost a bit of that sandbox nice layer of protection, because you're running privileged, you're allowing full host OS access. But there is another way to do it. It's a more granular way. And that includes using cgroup rules so that you can allow devices, your container to access devices, you know, on a per device basis. So if you have a graphical container, give it access to the GPU only. If you have a container that toggles a GPIO, give it access to the that GPIO only, and so on. And this is why we suggest as best practices that the intended use is to adopt all those security measures to have a secure application. If there is a leak in let's say libxyz in your Debian container, it cannot do much to the base system. You know, your critical application will be running there. And then if you add that to the fact that you can run multiple containers and orchestrate them, then you can have a lean container that does critical hardware access, where you don't install many libraries, you don't have you have a reduced attack surface. And then you have another container where you want to do something that's not as critical, and then there you install, you know, your database or something else. And so the question is, the answer is, you can do it pretty fast and without learning much, and then you lose a bit on the security. You can study a little bit of this, maybe spend half a day or a day looking into it, and your system will be much more secure by default. So that's what I suggest. Its intended use is not mandatory.
Gotcha.
And just a final thought, okay? Even if you run the most unsecure container possible, that defaults to being equal as running a system without container. And as an embedded developer, you know, even if you're not running containers, you want to make sure you're not doing something, you know, very crazy. So I think even for that use case, even though not recommended, not intended, it's not too bad, you know. It's just that because you start reading on security best practices and then you start getting worried.
You know? Yeah, and you know, the whole security principle of least privilege, I think, is kind of what you've been talking about there, right? So you give the container only the privileges it needs, and it does in general. And whether it's a container or an application, that's always a good practice. Okay, so in terms of updates, I know you mentioned, you know, we've got OS tree that updates, we've got Docker containers that update, but what's the, you know, how does what exactly happens during an update, and what are the different kinds of updates? Can you describe a little bit, you know, in terms of what's downloaded when, you know, what things are restarted or rebooted, that kind of thing?
Yeah. We have, looking from the top down, we have two different types of updates today. One of them is OS updates, operating system updates, and they update the base, the Torizon core. Those OS updates, they use OS 3, to download the diff of what has changed between two releases of your OS, and then they prepare or mark that new release to be used upon the next boot. So the system then reboots, and it tries to use your new OS 3 deployment. So let's say go from version 1 to version 2, or from Torizon Core 5.6.0 quarterly to Torizon Core 5.7.0 quarterly, as we've recently released that. And if all goes well, you know, we have some custom some logic in U-boot to allow for that to happen. Also defined, you know, how to do that in the libraries. Then you keep the two versions in the system, but you use the newer. And if something goes wrong, I don't know, unintended power cut, or I don't know, some connectivity issue, some data corruption, then the system will not boot successfully on the newer version, and it will automatically roll back to the older version and be marked as a failed OS update.
Okay.
Who handles all this back and forth with the server, all the metadata, is the actualizer library. And the OS 3 is only about the, you know, the file system handling. Okay.
And so the content for that update, though, that's stored on the Torizon platform servers, correct?
No, that so as of today, if you install a vanilla Torizon Core image just as we release it, the content is fetched from Artifactory. And if you install a custom one that you uploaded, we store it in a tree hub. It's technology for storing OS 3 artifacts. At the moment, the platform does not allow you to tell which server to use. For instance, if you want to have your own server in-house because, I don't know, for security reasons, in the future that might be possible. So now it's a good time, you know, for probing the market. If you really need it, you know, a lot, let us know, because that's very important info for us. But it's theoretically possible, you know, it's not let's say a huge change that we would have to do. And that's a better question for my colleague who leads the platform team.
Gotcha.
So maybe a follow-up question when he gets interviewed to the show. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So okay. So then, how does that's the OS tree operating system updates. How does that differ when you're talking about containers and applications?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That's the other big one. The application updates. So looking a bit under the hood, the applications, they are also handled by Actualizer. And since Actualizer comes from the automotive industry, usually the term used internally is ECU, you know, comes from the cars. And the OS is called a primary ECU. And in a system, you can have secondaries or secondary ECUs. And the containers, they are handled as a secondary ECU. What other secondary ECUs we could potentially have? The ARM Cortex M4 firmware, the bootloader artifacts, maybe. So those are also examples. And the container is a secondary ECU. So for the actualizer library, it's a secondary. And then how the data back and forth happens. Your containers, they are stored in what's called a Docker registry. And the most famous Docker registry is Docker Hub, or is hosted in Docker Hub, you know, not getting pedant on the terminology, but let's say it's Docker Hub. You could alternatively use other Docker registries to store your containers. And some of them are private, you know, you could use Amazon. They have a container registry. I think it's a, you know, ECR or something like that, Elastic Container Registry. I'm pretty sure Azure has its own, Google Cloud has its own, and you could even host your own. With a Docker container, you can start a registry in your own PC if you want. And then what Actualizer will instruct the board to do is to fetch the containers from those registries. So what you send to the platform is a Docker Compose file. It's just a definition of how your containers must be brought up, how they are interchanged, what hardware access they have, and from which registry they should be fetched. So when that metadata is on the board will reach out to each registry directly. So your data does not go through the platform.
Okay. So then but if you're doing a secure offline update, are registries involved at that point?
If you do a secure offline update, I would have to check with my technical guys, but they store all this data in your USB stick.
Okay.
They store an OS3 deployment, and I am not 100% sure how do they store the containers. If it's in a tarball or if there is a local registry in the USB stick, but yeah.
But regardless, they don't, the devices don't need connectivity to a to Docker Hub or whatever to be able to deploy that's all bundled into that lockbox.
Yeah, so when you create a secure offline update or you define your lockbox, you define it in the platform, but there's only metadata at that point.
Mm-hmm.
So even when you create your secure offline update, it's only metadata at the platform. Then to create your update medium, be it an SD card or a USB stick, you must use the TorizonCore builder. And there is a command that creates the lockbox. You know, it's defined in the server and created by TorizonCore builder. And when you run that command, it will access your various Docker registries and the Tree Hub or Artifactory or whatever, all the places or all the servers where your data is. So TorizonCore Builder will download all of that into the lockbox, which is basically a directory in your PC that you can copy to your update medium.
Gotcha. Okay, but so the registry is still accessed, but it's not by the device. It's actually by your development system.
Yes, and TorizonCore Builder supports, you can pass, you know, credentials if your registry is...
Gotcha.
Yeah, if it's protected.
All right. Well, very good, Leo. I appreciate you taking the time. I know we ran over. We'd run a little bit long of what we had planned for this portion of the call. But before I let you go, is there anything that we didn't discuss that you think is good information to pass on to the viewers of the stream? I mean, I know there's a lot more, you know, we can go into a lot more detail about the specifics, but I think, you know, keeping it at the functional high, you know, higher level stuff, did we miss anything?
Well, we've talked about application development, which is very important. We've talked about containers. You asked about Debian and why we have chose Debian and etc. I just want to, you know, keep that curiosity spark for our audience, and keep in mind that you are not, it's not mandatory to use Toradex containers. Mm-hmm. Actually, mm-hmm. You can and you should leverage the open source community, you know, to the extent that you deliver your product faster. And that even means that if you really don't like Debian and our approach, you could try another Linux distro in a container.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Yeah. And our Debian containers, they are on Docker Hub, so you can even see, hey, what did those guys do? And you could even port that to your favorite OS. So, you know, it's not a hard constraint. It will definitely make your life easier, save you time, but that's not a hard constraint. Then we talked about the hardware access, which often comes up. If you're having difficulty doing the hardware access, drop us a message in our community and we can address that either in the form of documentation or new features. Yep. Maybe a glimpse into the future. We have Torizon Core Builder, which is a command line tool. And we have integrated that into the IDE, adding a layer of reducing complexity, adding a layer of easy to use. But we know we can do more. So in the future, we plan to make a device configuration tool or whatever name it will have that allows you to very easily configure your pin muxing and your devices and carrier board customization and all of that.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, if you have good ideas, you know, or if you feel you're having trouble with something, do let us know, because that's very important for us to decide, you know, what's coming next. Yeah.
And I think that's a great point to wrap up on. If you do have feedback for us, we love feedback. We love feature requests. We like to hear how people are using our product. So in our community site, community.toradex.com is the best way to get that information to us. Myself and several of my colleagues are the first line of support on there. So if you have, if you post something there, it will definitely get routed to the right person. We love that. So, Leo, I just want to thank you for taking the time with us. Hopefully, it was good information for the users. And I will just end by saying have a nice weekend and thanks for taking the time.
Yeah, thank you, Drew. It's my pleasure to be here.
All right, very good.
Thank you all.
Very good. Bye now.
Bye-bye.
All right, so we got a few minutes left. I assume I'm still live here. I may not have any webcams or anything going. There we go. Now we're starting to get some things going. Let's see. Yeah, it looks like the webcam, since Zoom had locked my webcam, it is not going to be showing here. But we got just a few more minutes in the scheduled time, so I'm not going to go into too much depth on building the application. I think it was... I think the information we were getting from Leo was good information. So I think, we'll just talk a little bit about what the next steps in this live coding session are and maybe play a little bit with it today. But we'll kind of push the rest of it off to the next session. So my next goal here is to build an application. And you're seeing a website for Mycroft.ai. And this is a open source voice assistant, much like your Alexas and your I don't even remember what they're called for both Google and Apple. They both have them. But so this is an open source voice assistant. I have deliberately never worked with it because I wanted to as part of this live stream, I wanted that to be starting completely from scratch. I've seen a few demos of this. I've not actually run it myself. So that's kind of my objective, between now and the next session or two, depending on how far we get each time. So when I'm working on an application like this, especially, when it's, open source package that, in theory I can run on my desktop, one of the first things I'm going to try to do is just run it on my desktop, because that's usually, for a lot of these things, that's the way they're going to be built and packaged. So let's take a look. It's probably, I'm guessing, under technologies, because here it looks like they're trying to sell an actual hardware device. Let's see, built on Mycroft. So let's see if we can figure out where actually Minecraft, the open source portion, is. Let's see, links, contact, media kit, trademark. So this all seems to be about the company around it. Open data sets, languages, write code. Okay, so I am not finding this. So let's just Google for it. Minecraft AI, get started. GitHub, there it is. Let's see if the GitHub site gives us any clues. All right, so we see a bunch of repositories here. Start with the core, take a look. Ah, here we go, getting started and running. So, all right, so I'm going to actually run through these steps and just see what happens here. So I have got on my Ubuntu desktop here, let's just do that. Okay. And we will clone the core. And we will run through their setup script. Okay, so this is going to actually use the Python virtual env. So if we go into Minecraft core, let's just for fun take a look at the script, see what it's going to be doing. All right, so setting some variables. Okay, so that's if we want to clean it. Help stuff. Let's just get down here to the meat of it. So it's looking for things I guess you do. It's going to be prompting different things, checking the CPU to see what kind of acceleration we might have. Okay, well, there's a lot in here. This is a pretty big script, so I'm not going to be able to figure it all out in just a few minutes, but this is a VM, so let's just go ahead and do it. We'll run this and see what it asks for us. Okay. During the first run, okay, do you want to run on master or against a dev branch? Let's just stay on the master branch for now, I think. Yes, we'll go ahead and automatically check for updates. That's always a good idea, even though this is just an experiment. Mimic technology can run both locally and from a server. Local is more robotic, but always available. So we're going to go ahead and stick with the... Oh, it can take hours to build on slower machines. Ah, well, let's go ahead and do it anyway, because I think that might, for now, be... it'll be a more self-contained environment. These can be added to your system path. Sure, we'll put them in our profile. The standard location. Okay, now it's asking me for my password. Do you want to check code style? Sure, even though I don't anticipate I'll be submitting any code, any Minecraft skills, you never know. Okay, so it's installing a pre-commit hook to run that code style checker. That's interesting. Libjack Minecraft requires a conflicting package, and we'll like that's fine. Okay, so we're going to let it uninstall the package that it's not compatible with. That's fine, since, like I say, this is a VM. I'm okay with that. Yep. All these packages will be updated, so we'll let that happen. Oh, that is not good. Okay, I have network connectivity. That's interesting. I am getting a not found. Well, let's just do an APT update. I haven't done that in a while. Maybe my package database is out of sync. All All right, so we'll go ahead and run back through all these steps. Okay, that's good. It was able to pick back up where it left off without asking all the questions again. That's good. And now it is able to download the packages. That's good. So it was just a out-of-date package database. And this is installing a lot of stuff. This will be interesting for sure to try to get running on a Torizon device, as Leo was discussing, since we're based on Debian. And, of course, Ubuntu, which I'm running here in my VM, is based on Debian. That shouldn't be a problem. I would imagine most of these packages are going to be available to run inside the containers on Torizon, albeit probably not as speedy as they are on my high-powered desktop here. All right, while that's happening, let's scroll down through the page here. Okay, so then we just run the thing. There is a debug command. Now, this will be tricky in the VM, and especially while I've got the microphone connected up through the live stream. So we may not get. I may have to do some offline work to figure out the best way to demonstrate this. Maybe I'll just have to get a second microphone or something just to make sure it can be shared. But so then looking a little bit further, talks about how to use it. Okay, so they've got their own device and account management system. Okay, so we can pair to their site once we get it working. And then they've got skills, much like Alexa does. Let's, for fun, take a look at what skills they have available. All right, skills list. I'm just curious. MSK, Microsoft Skills Kit. We'll do that later. Yeah, I'm not seeing an obvious way to see the list of skills here, but we'll get there eventually once we get this thing running.
To kind of wrap up here, we're at the top of the hour. This is kind of just a sneak peek of what I'm going to be doing in the next session or so. But this is a very common workflow, right? I'll play with the software as much as possible on my desktop because it's fast. It's here. I don't have to hook anything else up. I'm ready to go. And then once I get a sense for how something like this will behave, then I'll start doing a very similar manual setup of Mycroft in a Torizon container. I'll probably just log into my Torizon device over SSH. I'll launch a container for Debian or Ubuntu, probably for consistency's sake. I'll probably launch the standard Torizon Debian reference container, and then I'll be in a shell prompt. As we discussed, I think, last time, anything I do in that shell prompt will not persist, but it's a good experimentation environment where I can, do exactly what I've done here. I can clone the Mycroft sources. I can try to build it, see how well that works. And then if that works, then I can see about developing a container. It wouldn't surprise me if there already is a container for this. So that would be, one of the steps I could take. In fact, before we wrap up here today, I will go ahead and check on the Docker Hub, see what we have, because that may actually be an even simpler way to get this thing running. Let's see. Yeah, so there are definitely some here. 100,000 plus downloads. So this seems to be an official containerized version of Mycroft. This is a development environment. I don't know. I'll have to experiment, play with that a little bit, see if that's what we need to actually run it, or if that's we're using that for just developing skills and that kind of thing. And then here's another one that's posted by another user that's running on Debian. So we've got a couple options there. Usually I would play with all of them just to kind of get a sense for what was available, and you know, if I like one of these containers well enough, then I might just use it directly. Otherwise I might end up developing my own custom container. So with that, I will say thank you guys for joining. If you have any feedback, please reach out. My email address, I'll post it again in the chat. If you have any feedback that would help us make this live streaming session more useful for you, if you have thoughts about interesting development challenges we could tackle and show how things are done in Torizon, please drop me a note. I would love that feedback. And if you enjoyed the interview with Leo and would like to talk to other members of the Torizon development team, we can set that up for future sessions as well. But with that, I will say good afternoon. Everybody have a nice weekend, and thanks again for your time.